how do you think someone who's maybe in a middle-class income, maybe earning $50,000 to $100,000 a year, living paycheck to paycheck, what should their kind of definition of rich be? Or what would they stand to gain out of learning to be rich from you?
Well, first off, if you're living paycheck to paycheck, the simplest answer is that you should just get out of that cycle, right? If you're living paycheck to paycheck, there are things you can do. I have something called the CEO strategy, which is called cut costs. Everybody knows that internally, but they waste their time cutting costs on meaningless things like lattes. Cutting back on lattes is like the worst advice ever. $3 a day doesn't even add up to that much. Plus, you feel guilty. It's the one joy you have in the morning, and you don't even do it. So people waste their time, their limited cognitive resources, focusing on $3. Why don't you just stop that and focus on the big areas you can cut? Negotiating your salary. That's an example of the E part, which is earning more. That's another thing most people don't think about. So they're like, oh, I got to cut back on like the type of paper clips I buy. But they forget that there's a limit to how much you can cut, but no limit to how much you can earn. And then O is for optimizing your spending. So I think for most people who are in that paycheck to paycheck situation, the first thing would be to start putting aside some savings every month. And it doesn't matter if it's $20, $200, $2,000. The most common objection to that is people will be like, there's no way I can cut back anymore. And I'm like, okay, I'm being polite, but in my head, I'm like, here we go. And trust me, I love these conversations. So I say, okay, well, what have you tried? They're like, I tried everything. I'm like, tell me. They're like, you know, I like try to eat out less. I'm like, okay, that's cool. And what else? Well, I mean, there's nothing else. I mean, I can cancel my phone service. They went from eating out less to canceling their phone service. Like, that's the extent of the thought that's gone into it. So there are things that can be done that are on a big scale. There are also things like calling up the subscriptions and using the scripts in my book, literally negotiating your fees down. And those fees accumulate, right? They're accretive. So you're not just saving $10 a month or $50 a month. It's going over years and years. So that's the first place I would say, Scott, to get out of that cycle. Before you can look ahead and talk about financial independence, you need to be having some money being saved automatically every month.
Love it. When I think about cutting spending, I'll think about, hey, there's fixed and variable costs here, right? And what it sounds like you're talking about is you know, those fixed costs, those subscriptions are really kind of an easy way to cut. If you cut those, you're just automatically saving lots of money every month versus the latte, which is a quote unquote a variable cost, but is a behavioral thing that you've got to go in and change from there. When it comes to some of the larger expenses, you know, if you break out average American household spending, you've got 33% of that spending is in house, you know, living expenses, the mortgage, the rent, all that kind of stuff, housing. Then you've got another 17% at transportation, and the next 13% is going to be food. It's sad that I know these statistics off the top of my head, but that's, I guess, the territory here. You know, when you think about it, do you have any advice on those three big categories for cutting those out?
I do. And first of all, I love that you know those offhand. Listen, anyone listening to this podcast, and certainly if you're interviewing, you're kind of a weird like nerd. Okay. All of us are weird. Let's just admit it. If you guys are like, if you know the difference between a Roth 401k and you're a weirdo. So we're all in good company here. I think that I really like to be conservative on the big items. So I have something I call the tripod of stability. And for me, I really want to be stable in where I live, my employment, and my relationships. Just like pure stability. As an example, I moved to New York 10 years ago. I've lived in the same apartment ever since. My net worth has increased during that time, but I stayed. I'm perfectly happy. It's a great place. I'm good. My computer, 7 years old. It works. It runs. It might sound like an airplane, but it works. But what that does, being conservative in those areas, allows me to be very risk-seeking in others. It allows me to invest aggressively. It allows me to take risks with my business and also to honestly just splurge on the things that I love. So I would say that if most people actually followed a few simple formulas when it came to their spending, they would be in really good shape. Here's some simple formulas I have. You know, I want to have a one-year emergency fund, cash. That's a little bit more aggressive than most, but I like it. I want to have a no debt policy overall. And if I do use debt, it would be maybe for a house. And if so, I would start with 20% down minimum, if not more. And I have several other rules that I use that are very, very conservative. Though, if you follow things like 28% of your pay for housing, if you just follow those basic rules, you're going to be in a really good conservative position. What happens is most people overspend on the big things. They forget to account for the phantom costs. And then they wake up one day and they're like, where's all my money? Well, the money you can't find, you spent it 6 years ago in a poor decision you made.
I love that concept of the one-year emergency fund in cash, and that how you just applied that thinking to, hey, that allows me to take risks in other areas and be much more aggressive. So does your investment portfolio reflect a very aggressive outlook, given that you have a large cash cushion there? Is that what you're, is that how you're structuring things?
It's actually a backwards bending curve, because once you start off, you know, in general, if you're young, you're slightly more risk-seeking. But, you know, I always, there's a new billboard that's going around in New York, and it says, be better than average. It's complete You should actually be average and you should be happy with it. Oh, be better than average. Like, of course, oh, I want to have a better than average relationship. I want to have a better than average bicep. But actually in investing, you should be perfectly happy with 8% returns. It's great. It's the real problem comes when you try to get 18% returns, and then 16 years from now, you realize, oh man, I really wasn't as smart as I thought. So no, so the backwards bending part happens as you become wealthier, you actually cut down on your risk. There's a great story about Susie Orman. You know, she recommends people have, you know, simple index funds, et cetera. And then one reporter in the New York Times asked her, how much do you have? She said, I have about 25 million bucks or so. They said, where do you invest it? She said, I put $1 million in the market and I put all the rest in bonds. And everyone in the personal finance community was outraged. Oh my God. Oh, why would Susie Orman tell everyone bonds? Well, Susie Orman has 24 million reasons than you to put her money in bonds. She already won the game of personal finance. So once you win the game, you don't have to compete at the same growth levels as other people. Therefore, I'm risk seeking in my business, but in my investments, I have a very stable, roughly 70-30 portfolio equities. And it is, I wouldn't call it aggressive. I wouldn't call it conservative. It's slightly aggressive. That's it.
It's average.
It should be average. Exactly.
Yeah. Love it.